Hey! Yes, Lord. Ooh. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yes, Lord. Yeah. You know, we'll sing along. Trust in your name, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Able to save and deliver us. See, we put our hope in your name, Jesus. See, blessing and honor.
Blessing and honor. Glory and power unto our God forever and ever. All of the honor, all of the praise is Lord.
Shout of praise to Jesus. Hey, come on, let's lift them up. Hey, let's go.
Alleluia.
Let's be sing.
Alleluia. Our God reigns.
Hey.
Alleluia.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Alleluia.
Clap our hands to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You know this song, it's simple. You just have to shout with a voice of triumph like this. Say, oh!
Oh, 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 oh. Nothing's impossible.
on if you believe it. Clap your hands if you know that our God is in control. Make some noise. Oh, hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor, say, we are just warming up. Ha ha. You know what? Let's declare, hey, hey, let's go. Hey, come on, let's declare, hey,
let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Let everything that has breath,
that has breath
praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let everything
that has breath,
that has breath
praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let everything
that has breath,
that has breath
praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting. I praise when I'm not, praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water my enemy's drowning. As long as, let's go,
as long as I breathe, I've got a reason.
Oh,
say something this time? Come on! I'm here to tell you, Jesus is in the building. I'm here to tell you, this is our first mega Sunday service here. Let's go, everyone, round of applause. You may all take a seat. Welcome to our very first mega Sunday service here in the Joan, Sutherland Field Performance Building in Penrith. And I'm going to tell you something, it's not home of the Panthers. We're here to tell you, this is a home of Jesus right now. That's a good one. Welcome in the name of Jesus. We really want to welcome our awesome guest speaker. Man, this weekend has been, all I know is this weekend has been big. It has done something in my heart like I never knew before. I want to show you something that Pastor, I spoke to this morning. He goes, life makes you small, but Jesus makes you bigger. And if you are brand new, we are believing that for you, that you are not here by some coincidence. You are here because God ordained you to be here. And we're believing that God is going to make your life bigger like never before. So after service, we have our awesome New Life team outside there. They'll be in the orange vests and orange flags waving it because we want to get you guys connected and engaged into a community that believes for bigger things than you, man. This weekend, I believe that Jesus is bigger. My faith is bigger. My prayers are bigger. My vision is bigger. Why? Because I'm here and there's such an impartation. So I just want to honor the pastor for such an awesome word. Thank you for imparting such a mighty thing you do. So everyone say, I'm going to do something. Everyone say, get ready. Someone a little bit louder. Everyone say, get ready. That's all that I need you guys to do today is get ready for God to do something like never before, honestly. That's all I'm going to get you to do. So without further ado, we believe in our church the power of giving, the power of tithes and offering. And as usual, we hear throughout the whole life of our church what it means in the individual life as a believer, what it means to give to God and give to His house. So without further ado, I want to introduce to you, everyone give a Holy Spirit welcome, so all of Penrith can hear it, to the one and only Chloe. Come on, Chloe, let's go. Come on, church, let's go.
Thank you. How are we all feeling today? How are we all feeling tonight? I just want to welcome everyone in the building and to those who are new in the name of Jesus. First and foremost, I'd like to give all the praise and glory to our King Jesus, just for everything He has done. And I'd also like to honor our senior pastors, seniors Gus and Jan, and also just the pastoral team, just for continuously sowing into the house of God. And, you know, just for your leadership. So a bit about myself. My name is Chloe, for those who don't know me. I've been attending Revelations for 4 years on and off, and I recently came back like about 4 months ago. So just a bit about my back history is I grew up Catholic, you know, so I've always just known the Catholic life. I got baptized August 20th, so that's when I realized, when I done doctrines, was that I don't want to be a religious person. I want to be a daughter of Christ. So that's when I changed my life. Okay, why I tithe and give is the question. But you know what? Why not tithe and give? Jesus gave His life. Jesus gave His life so that we could be free, so that we could be saved. You know? All He asks is that 10%. He's not asking for you to, you know, cut off your arm, cut off your leg. Do you know what I mean? Like, He just wants your obedience. And what came to me was faith. He wants your faith. He wants you to just believe in Him, to trust in Him. Something I learned from doctrines that really struck me was money is not evil. Rather, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. The other thing was people have strayed from faith due to undealt with heart issues concerning money. Faith. Where is your faith? You know, like, I never used to tithe and give, but ever since I did, like, ever since I have, oh man, it is life-changing. It is so life-changing because it's not all about how much I'm giving, but because of how much faith I have in God. So in saying that, the scripture I would love to share with you all is Philippians 4:6. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. So if you'd like to know more about the biblical principle of tithing, then sign up to Doctrines. Trust me, it's life-changing. It is the best. Or if you have it in your heart to tithe or give, there are two ways of giving. We have our online accounts, Revelations Church Oceania, where you offer your tithings, Harvest Ministry. This goes towards assisting those who are in need in the life of the church. And Revelations Mission, supporting the ministry work overseas. And we also have the QR code. Thank you all, and God bless.
Come on, everyone, give a Chloe a round of applause. We love when our community shares about, not just about giving, but the transformation of Jesus Christ in our lives. And that's part of our vision. Another part of our vision is impacting generations. We as a community, we believe in the next generation using our gifts to glorify God and spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, the vision of SEEK, if I can say it to you, is raising up true worshipers in spirit and in truth. Let me tell you, Penrith needs this type of generation that will glorify Jesus. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce to you SEEK Worship.
His hands and his feet, waiting for me.
Amazing gifts in our youth, and some amazing, amazing gifts. In the vein of our youth, let me read you the vision of our youth, empowering youth to shift society. That is a vision, man. That is an awesome vision. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce to you a multimedia. Let me introduce to you World Changers.
World full of idols. There is a call for a generation to find true transformation. A call to take a stand, to mandate God's purpose and plan. I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams, and your young men will see visions. The generation who will change the world for Jesus through their transformation.
I am a world changer.
I am a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I am a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I am a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I am a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I am a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
I'm a world changer.
What's up, Mega Service?
Let's make some noise. Hey, we're gonna try something new. Why don't you follow me? Hey!
Ho! Hey!
Ho! Hey! Ho!
Jesus. So ready? I'm going to say you fall, you say Jesus. You fall.
Jesus.
You fall.
Jesus.
Hey, why don't you make some noise for Jesus?
Let's go. Hey. Man, it's so good to see all your beautiful faces at our very first mega service. Why don't you make some noise?
Hey, you know what? We want to take this time to honor our incredible Lord and Savior, King Jesus, for what he has, who he is, what he's done, and what he's about to do in everybody's life. And you know, we also want to take this time to honor our incredible senior pastor, Pastor Gus and Jenna, and your incredible children. We are so grateful for the leadership, the faithfulness, and the strength that you guys carry in the name of Jesus. We also want to take this time, special mention, to thank Pastor John, Cameron, make some noise.
Yo.
Hey, we are so grateful, and we are just ready to receive what God is about to continue to do inside of our mega service through you.
Well, World Changers is just around the corner.
Let's go.
Ladies and gentlemen, 12 days out,
12
and
days.
We're here to challenge a parent, caregivers.
Yeah.
If you have a youth or you know a youth,
come on.
We want you guys to register them to our youth conference.
Yeah, come on.
Why? Because we're losing so much of our youth to the devil. And we are here to put a stake down and believe for the now generation.
Yes, come on.
So if that is you and you're wanting to make that challenge, we want to partner with you so that we can partner with God.
You know what? And something powerful that Pastor John had shared this morning was locate yourself. We want our young
Amen.
People to locate where they currently
yeah.
are and then find Jesus and have a true transformation,
yeah.
not just at youth conference, but until eternity. And so, you know what, family? Partner with us tonight. We're going to be out in the foyer, like Pastor Rob said, and let's see a generation one for our King Jesus. Let's go.
Amen.
Everyone, give them a round of applause to our mighty youth pastors there. World changers, excited for that, excited for our youth. So if we're going to get everyone, please, standing up. You know, after Mega Sunday, Monday is going to come. Tuesday is going to come. Wednesday is going to come. And we are a church, we are a community that believes in doing life every day. So without further ado, get engaged, get connected, and really lean in. I like what Pastor Gass said. He goes, we are people of God. We don't lean back like the world. We lean in. So lean in and get connected into our community as I introduce to you The Refresh.
Welcome to The Refresh. We get a refresh on what's happening in the life of our church. Check it out. Tomorrow, Monday night at 7 p.m., we have our last men's embrace group gathering. So to all the men out there, make sure you come on down, invite a friend, and let's finish the term strong. This Thursday, we have our Revelations, She is Daughter Women's Night. Doors open at 6 p.m. There will be worship, testimonies, and women gathering under the name of Jesus. So bring a friend along, you won't regret it. Friday at 6 p.m. we have Youth Ignite. So to all our young people, come on down and let's finish the term strong. There will be worship, challenges, food, and the Word of God. You don't want to miss out. Set your alarms bright and early for 6 a.m. House of Prayer. It's going to be a powerful morning as we seek the Father's heart for our family, community, and our city. Get excited, church, because this upcoming Saturday on the 23rd, our very own senior pastor Gus is launching his first book, Ministers of Fire. This will be launching at 6 p.m. here at the building, so pre-register via Facebook or Instagram at Augustine Ahil Ministry or send an email to augustineahil.ministry@gmail.com. This is something that you don't want to miss out. To get connected or for any other information, you can head to revelationschurchoceana.com or visit our Connect Hub out in the foyer today. That'll be all our notices for the week. Signing out on The Refresh.
Come on, let's give it up for The Refresh. And can you turn to the person behind you and say, stay connected. Let's just posture our hearts and let's just get to a time of worship. Lord, oh, we worship you tonight, Lord. Oh, we give you praise, Lord. You be so good to us, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, we give you love, Lord. Yes, Lord. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will see of the goodness of God all my life. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good.
So
every breath that I have
been, oh I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love your voice, I love your voice. See, you will lead me through the fire. In the darkness I, you are close like no other. Known you as, known you as a father. And known you as a friend. Oh, I I love your voice, I love your voice. See, you have led me through the fire. And the darkness I, you are close like no other. Known you as, I known you as a father.
Promises. Yes, Lord, you will never leave us nor forsake us, oh God. And your word will not return to you void. Everything will come to pass as long as we put our trust in you, oh God. Oh, there's nothing to hide for our God. There's nothing to hide for our God. Oh, yes, Lord, your goodness is running out. It's running after me. Your goodness is running out. It's running after me. When my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running out. It's running out. Can you believe it? See,
your goodness is running out.
Hey,
it's running out.
See,
your goodness is running out.
It's running out. When my life lay down,
surrender
now. Family, see, all my life, you have me so. With every breath, that's the church. Come on, let's lift that voice to Him. Oh,
I will sing.
Oh, I will sing. days of my life, I will sing, oh God, of your goodness, of your faithfulness, of your wonders, of everything. You are faithful, Lord.
Oh, I will, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Oh,
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. See your promises being fulfilled. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my.
Come on, if you're gonna have faith to believe it,
all over,
you're gonna have faith to catch it. I see the evidence. Let's go.
I see the evidence of your good
all over, Lord,
all over my.
Come on and clap your hands if you know he is faithful to his promises. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
You are Alpha and Omega. We worship. You are worthy to be praised. You are Alpha.
Jesus. Come on, lift your voice. Shout. If I can have a little bit more light here, that's okay. I just want to see God's people. Come on, just where you are, begin to just declare the name of Jesus. Lift him up in your midst right now. Glorify him. Lift him up. All the glory and the honor and the power and the praise be unto God. Yes. If I can have a little bit of light in the congregation, if that's okay. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, we give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. Church, I hope you're ready. I said, I hope you're ready. You know, there's just a sense as we're giving God all the glory, as we're lifting up the name of Jesus. Old chapters closed. Old eras closed. Old seasons closed. Old pain gone. Old endings ended. I just want to look around your church and tell the person next to you, say, this is our future. This is our future. Do you believe it, church? Do you believe that the church of Jesus Christ is still alive? We don't believe the naysayers. Like I said, and we've said it before, the gangs don't own the streets. The house of God owns the streets. The fact that we're here tonight, we're drawing a line in the sand. We're putting a stake in the ground. We're declaring from the Riff all the way to Parramatta, all around Sydney, all to Australia, that the Church of Jesus Christ is still alive. Jesus has risen from the dead. And what an occasion. Come on, just turn to the person next to you and say, I can feel the faith coming off you. I can feel it. This is our new destiny, Pastor. This is our new destiny. I said, this is now a new destiny. If you were in the service this morning, Apostle John Cameron was talking about how often our tent can be what holds us back. And you know, as much as 3/36 Stoddard Road has been amazing, we're looking to the future now. We honor God for the past, but we're looking to the future now. I said, we're looking to the future. And what do we see? A blood-washed Australia is what we see. A blood-washed Blacktown is what we see. Restored people and a generation, a whole city, bowing down to the glorious name of Jesus. Are you with me here? Are you with me? And I don't know, man, but we're so blessed. We've got an incredible man of God with us. If you've been at the volunteers meeting, morning service, there's just been such a huge impartation. And we don't say this lightly. John Cameron is a once-in-a-lifetime leader. He built the biggest church in Australia, in New Zealand, literally changed a generation, and he's here in this next season to be able to impart. And can I just say, John, as much as you've been so incredible, what a humble man of God you are. Just to be able to spend time and, you know, pour out his wisdom, not holding back, just a big-spirited. And I don't know about you, but If something didn't shift in you this weekend, you possibly may not be breathing. See me after for some face-to-face resuscitation. No, we don't do that anymore. But guess what? It's not too late. Tonight, we're stepping in. Come on, touch the person next to you and say, tonight, we're stepping in. I want you to lean in because he carries a word for this generation. And in this next era, and listen, don't worry, it's not going to be the last time we see Apostle John here. We'll bring him over to help build the structures, but we're going all in. Are we going all in? Can we believe it? Yeah. They say, you know what they say? They say, you can't get a church strong in Blacktown. It's the church's graveyard. Yeah, let the naysayers what they say. When the word of God comes, it will never return void. And you know what, church? We're not even first choice. We're like in the pecking order, but it doesn't matter. All glory to Jesus, and we crush the devil right now. Come on, touch the person next to you. And say, come on, somebody. Touch the person. Argh! Argh! That's not the Panthers roar. That's the Lion of Judah roar. I'm just angry my Eels didn't make the premiership, but hey, where's all these after wars guys, hey? Need to pray for ya. Anyway, lean in. I'm gonna let the man of God just run. And church, you know what? I want you to honor the man of God. You know, we're a house of honor, and honor releases the gift. I want you to join me giving a Holy Spirit and thanking Jesus for raising people. And John, again, thank you, man, for not giving up and being with us. And church, come on, why don't we do it? Give a round of applause to Apostle John Cameron. Come on, somebody. Come on, church. Come on, church.
Can we give Jesus some praise in this room tonight? Come on. Come on, 5 more seconds. Praise Him! We give you glory, Jesus. Amen and amen. Anybody else feel like they're in a pivotal moment being in this room tonight? You're here and something being born in the heart of this church. We're taking ground for God. We're plundering hell and populating heaven. We're taking a bold step tonight into something new for Revelations Church. And if you believe that, could you give God some praise in this room tonight? Woo! I love it, I love it, I love it. Why don't you slap a high five with 10 people and say, I'm so glad to be here with you tonight. You may be seated. Man, wow. The presence of God, the Spirit of God that is at work in this place tonight. This is a crazy, crazy honor to be here with you on such a pivotal moment tonight. Thank you, team. Don't go too far. I'll call you back in just a minute. But can we give it up for this incredible worship team? Come on, give it up, give it up, give it up. These guys, I doubt they've even had a break this afternoon because they packed down from church this morning, packed in here tonight. I mean, the sound is excellent. The worship team are amazing. I'm sorry, I've forgotten the name, but the beautiful young girls from the youth ministry. Seek. Can we give it up for the Seek girls as well? Wow. Yeah, come on, do it properly. Give it up for these girls. They're amazing. Then our praise and worship team, we went to heaven tonight. Anybody else? I was like, don't send me up. Just keep singing. We give you all. I won't ruin the night for you by singing. Your pastor can sing. And I'm a one-talent guy, but there we go. But the praise and worship, exceptional, the sense of God's presence that is here. It's just such an incredible honor to be here. And I know that this is a pivotal moment for us in the journey of Revelations Church as we're, you know, Pastor Gus, I truly believe it. Like just looking at this auditorium, I believe God is going to expand the borders of this church's tent. He's going to stretch the tent curtains wide. You will increase. You will spread out to the left and to the right. And your descendants, the prophets prophesied in Isaiah, will dispossess desolate cities. And I feel like God is saying He's going to give you breakthrough doors in buildings. He's going to give you breakthrough doors in buildings. And repurpose kingdom resources for where the Spirit of the Lord is moving. Anybody else here just sense the mantle of God upon this man as he stands here tonight and says, Blacktown will be the revival, blood-washed Australia. There is a touch of heaven upon this great man and woman of God that is there to see the church established. This is a breakthrough church. This is an apostolic house. We're going to raise up a generation of leaders. We're going to change Australia for Jesus. We're going to change stats. We're going to change statistics. They're going to try and work out in some government office in Canberra, why is everything going so well in Blacktown, in Penrith, in the west of Sydney? And they're going to drill down until finally they find that young people and old people are coming alive in their faith in an amazing church called Revelations. And literally the history books are being rewritten because of what God is doing here. And if you believe that's possible, or even if you just dream that that's possible, take 3 seconds and give your God some praise in this room. Can we do that? Can we do that? Come on, can we do that? Whoa! Church, can we thank this evening this man and this woman for their faithful leadership, for their perseverance, for their being willing to step out? If you love your pastors, Pastor Gus and Pastor Jan, can you put your hands together and honor this man and this woman of God? We love you. We love you. What an honor it is to be here with you. Well, church, honestly, I stood in church this morning ready to go for tonight's service. And every time I just got into the presence of God or had a moment, I felt like the Lord just kept saying to me, I want you to preach this message tonight. So I'm out of the boat this evening. I've had to change my plans to follow what the Holy Spirit has been leading me with. But I just sense this is going to be a word for somebody in this room. So if you have a Bible, yeah, come on. If you believe the Word of God changed his lives, come on. Put your hands together and give God some praise in this room tonight. And if you have a Bible, we're going to go to the book of Joshua, chapter 1 and verse 1. If you don't have a Bible, you can use the screen or turn to a nearby Christian. Joshua, that was a joke. Yeah, five people got it. Joshua, chapter 1 and in verse 1, this is an incredible introduction to the book of Joshua. And it says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. We've just set our foot into something bigger. We've just set our foot, Revelations, into a whole new dimension of building. And what does God's word tell us tonight? I will give you a few places. Some places. One or two places. No. I will give you, help me say it, I will give you every place where you set your foot as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the great river, the Euphrates or the Hittite country, to the great sea on the west. No one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. That'll preach. And then in verse 6, God spoke these words over Joshua. He said, be strong and courageous, for you are the one. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one. 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 Be strong and courageous, for you are the one. I need you to tap at least five people around you and tell them you are the one. Tell them you are the one. 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 My son Will is 6'2". You wouldn't believe it looking at me. Literally, when I give my son a hug good night, my cheek goes against his chest. And he has my voice, literally. So when he says good night, it's with a boom. It's like, good night, Dad. And it's like, who is the father and who is the son? But when my son was young, that meant that he experienced a lot of pain. Growing that quickly, being always a very tall kid, he went through a lot of pain. And he loved to play soccer. For 7 years, every Saturday, he would play soccer down at our local soccer club, the Tower Football Club in Wellington. And every single Saturday morning, I would watch his game. I've watched his games all over the world. My wife standing there with her cell phone, me watching wherever I was. I've woken at 2 a.m. I've sat back out the back on little areas at conferences, watching him play his game. And I remember at the start of one particular year, we were in preseason. And Will was in a lot of pain. We'd pick him up from school and he'd be walking down the street to the car and he'd be limping and he was experiencing pain because he was so tall all through his lower legs and down into his feet. A lot of pain. He couldn't last his football practice, and so we booked an appointment with a specialist. And on a Friday afternoon before a very key grading game, I managed to get him in with a specialist to have a look at what was going on with his legs and his feet. The specialist took a look at him. She said he's experiencing growth pains, blah, 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 blah. And eventually she straps up his foot and sends us back out the door. As we're heading towards the door, I said to her, I said, can he play soccer tomorrow? She said, I don't know. You just have to see how he goes. So I text his coach and I said, Coach Carl, is there any chance that Will could just play only one half of the game? He's in a lot of pain, but I think he could probably last one half. He texts me back, no problem, I got you. The next morning we turn up. This is a key grading game. The year before, we'd been literally undefeated, won every single game throughout the entire competition, and we'd ended on an absolute high, and now we've got the chance to be graded up to the top league in the Wellington area. You can imagine there's a lot on this game. We start playing, and my son Will, you need to understand, he never ever wanted to play up the front. Every six-year-old boy wants to play up the front and score all the goals, but Will had always wanted to be a defender. That's what his name means. It means defender of the faith, Will. And he'd always wanted to play defender, and he'd anchored the defense for season after season. So we start the game. We're 2 minutes in. Every time we've got the ball, we're looking incredibly dangerous. But the moment they get the ball, they're just rolling through all of our boys. 6 minutes in, they score their first goal. 8 minutes in, they score their second goal. 9 minutes in, they missed a shot on goal. We're in 10 minutes into a 60-minute game, and already we're 2-0 down with one that could have been scored. I remember the coach is like frantic. He's on the side. He can't work out what to do. And he turns to my son, Will, and he says, Will, I need you to go out onto this field. Are you strong enough right now? Are you physically capable to take this field and to anchor this defense for me? Our forwards look great. Our defense is not going so well. Can you take the field? Can you anchor this defense for me? I saw my son look up at him. The coach is next only to God in his eyes. He looks up at the coach and he says, yes, coach, I can. And this little boy, maybe 10 years old, goes running out onto that field, 8 years old, I can't remember, running out onto that field, and he played the next 50 minutes of that game. The final whistle blew and he hobbled off the field, got to the sideline of the pitch, and just collapsed onto the ground. He was done for the day. But our team walked away with a 5-3 win over that opposition and got graded up to the next level. He didn't even gather in the team huddle. He just sat there on the ground in obvious pain. I looked down at him and I said, well done, son. He looked up at me with eyes that had a little bit of pain, but I knew that he knew that in that moment, somebody had been needed. That a situation wasn't going well. And within his grasp was the ability to make the difference that could turn the situation around. And when the hour was needed, cometh the hour, cometh the man. He'd stepped up to the plate and did what he could do, and the outcome had been altered. And I saw within his young eyes the knowledge that he was the one. He was the one. He was the one. My favorite sporting moment in all of sport history, and I love to watch good sport, is the 2016 Super Rugby Final. I'm a Hurricanes fan. I'm a Wellington boy, and a lot of the players come through my church, and I'll be a Hurricanes fan till the day I die, even though they've strictly never won the Super Rugby tournament. But I'm faithful. I'll be yellow till the day I die. And I remember in the 2016 final, our captain at this particular year was a player by the name of Dane Coles. Several weeks before the final, Dane had fractured two of his ribs in the middle of playing one of the games. I've fractured my ribs on more than one occasion, and I'm telling you, it's one of the most painful things you can ever imagine. Jumping fills you with pain. Hugging fills you with pain. Sleeping fills you with pain. But it's finals, and he's our captain. The game starts, Dane Coles come out onto the field and he's playing the match. The commentary box is electric. Here he is with fractured ribs playing this game of rugby. And guys, if you know Dane Coles, he doesn't just play, he gives it 120%. He plays number two and yet he scores tries faster than the back line. He's an electric player and he's all over the pitch and he's lifting the team and we're doing so well. Gets to halftime. They come back after halftime, and 43 minutes into the game, Dane goes into a tackle. He's obviously hurt. He's on the ground. He's not getting up, and eventually, with the support of the support staff, he gets up from the field, and he hobbles to the sideline. 43 minutes in, his job is done. He sits in his seat. It's freezing cold, so they put a large jacket over him. And he's not really sitting in his seat. You know what I mean? Like his hips on the outside. He's leaning back to relieve the pressure that's in his chest and his rib cage. And then the game keeps going, and the commentary box lights up. Because the player that's gone on to take Dane's position is the only person we have that can play hooker for the team. So if this person gets injured, then there is no one else to come in and fill the gap. The unthinkable happens. 10 more minutes into the game, the substitute hooker is in a head clash. He goes to the ground and they have to take him off for a concussion test. The camera pans to Dane. He's sitting there on the side of the pitch. He realizes what's going on. He's been in the agony of his pain, but he realizes that the player is down and not getting up. So he stands to his feet, shakes off the jacket that's been on him, and like blind Bartimaeus at the side of the road, he begins to take bold steps forward. Suddenly into the shot, three coaching staff materialize, blocking Dane's access to the pitch. But you know how they have microphones on the side of the pitch and you can hear them mouthing, and I swear I could almost hear them saying, "Let me on, let me on. I'm ready to play, let me on." I'm sitting at my house, I'm crying, tears are coming down my eyes. The selflessness, the sacrifice, the fortitude, the inner resolve. He went onto the field. He played 10 more minutes until the hooker was cleared from his concussion test and came back onto the pitch. And for me, it's my favorite sporting moment in all of history as a leader, as a man, as someone standing in a situation new. I might be in pain and there might be issues going on and there's an easy a path for me to take, but there's a moment that's here and there's an hour that has presented itself and a situation that has to be resolved, and you refuse to be passive and you refuse to stay on the sidelines. And Dane Cole just stepped up to the plate and he said, "I am the one. I am the one. I am the one." In our amazing passage of scripture that we're reading from tonight, we've got the nation of Israel standing literally at the edge of the Jordan River. You have to understand that getting Israel to the edge of the Jordan River had taken God 700 years of human history to bring this moment to pass. And don't think for a moment that this moment is insignificant, because it is only through this moment that we have the nation of history. It defines the history of the world, what happens next. This moment too is written in scripture. 1 Corinthians tells us, in order for you and I to learn from, because it is an example for us on whom the fulfillment of the ages has now come. Standing at the edge of the Jordan, Moses has just climbed a mountain and he hasn't come back. And God speaks to Joshua in these opening words of Joshua's account of the conquering of the promised land. God's first seven words to him are so powerful that maybe you need to hear them. The first five are so important for anybody in this room who's hanging on to what didn't work in your yesterday, or is feeling limited by maybe a mistake or even an intentional sin that has happened in the past in your life. Where God just addresses Joshua and he says, Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. I'm here to tell you tonight that when you're thinking about your life and your future, don't let the devil for one moment take you back to what happened yesterday. The only one who wants you to live in the pain of your yesterday is Satan himself. God comes to your life tonight and he says, Moses is dead. Your past is dead. Your sin is dead. Your shame is dead. Your guilt is dead. Your limits are dead. Moses, my servant, is dead. The next two words orient us towards where God wants you to live your life. As he then says to Joshua, now then, where every piece of the fiber of your being, where God wants you to live your life, is in your now and in your then. The devil is trying to replay your yesterday. God wants you to embrace your today. The devil wants you limited by your bygones. God wants you standing in your promises. He wants you possessing the future that he has for you. Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, he goes on and he explains to him that he'll give him every place where he sets his foot, that he'll never leave him or forsake him. And by the way, for anybody here who's thinking this is for Joshua, no. Jesus said, I will never, almost echoes the same words, I will never leave you. Jesus said, I will never forsake you. And once everything is established about what God has for him next, it's like God gets super personal and he sort of, in my mind, is almost looking at Joshua like, I sense heaven is just whispering over you tonight. And he said, be strong and courageous, for you are the one. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one. I don't have another Joshua. There is no plan B. I've been working for 700 years to get ready for this moment. God's saying to you tonight, you're not living in the west of Sydney just because you're an amoeba that got lucky. You're not here because a monkey grew to become a human and eventually you existed. But a creator God who saw all the span of history before the world ever came to be, look down in the year 2023 and he saw Sydney and he saw the West and he saw your neighborhood and he saw your workplace and he saw your school and he saw your university. He saw your family and he saw your address and he said, I've got a plan for your life and a purpose for you, and you're here for a reason and you're alive for this moment. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one. For you are the one. If there's one thing God needed Joshua to know, it is that he is going to be with him. He's going to work wonderful things for him. That when God is with you, the most miraculous things can and they do take place. Friends, I've seen eyes opened. I've seen cancers disappear. I've seen stadiums filled with people worshiping. I've watched as the crowds have come to know the Lord. I've seen buildings built and watched people take steps of faith. But I need you to know, not in one occasion did God do it without the partnership of a man or a woman. Every time God moves in history, it's because God has the power and we have the willingness. The miracle happens when we begin to move. The blessing happens when we begin to take steps. The doors open when we begin to step forward. The cancer goes when we begin to pray. Everything rises and falls, not on the power of God, that's constant, but on the willingness of us as His followers. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one. For you are the one. See, friends, Israel at this moment in history has a really significant challenge, a national identity crisis. You've got to understand that the Israelites are God's chosen people, beginning all the way with Abraham, whom we preached about this morning, flowing down to Isaac, to Jacob, to the 12 tribes. They have always been God's people, God's promises over them. They know, they've known for 700 years that they are God's chosen people, a separate people, a favored people. They know that their identity is wrapped up in the fact that God is going to give them the land that is on the other side of the Jordan. But at the same time, as they're living with that knowledge of who they are and what God's called them to do, they've spent the last 400 years as slaves in Egypt. Egyptian slave masters beat their backs while their priests told them that they were God's people. They knew what it was to live with the confusion of having a present reality that was filled with lack and difficulty and setback. And then to open God's word or to hear somebody talking and to hear them declare, you're the chosen person of God, you're alive for a reason, you're here because God wants you to use you. It's a very confusing thing. But the truth is, friends, as long as you're a follower of Jesus, there'll always be a profound distance between the potential of your dreams and the reality of your present. This is a tension to be managed. It's not something to be discarded. And certainly as God's people, we shouldn't ever let go of our dreams to feel comfortable in our present. God doesn't want you just settling down, being content with what you have because His word seems so much greater than what you're experiencing. No, God wants you alive with a promise, living with destiny, grabbing hold of potential. Believing in the spite. 400 years of slavery is followed by 40 years in the wilderness. 40 years. For 40 years they've been wandering around in the wilderness. The only way they ever lived, the only way they were ever fed was because God would supernaturally feed them. Something called manna, M-A-N-N-A, would just appear on the ground every morning. In Hebrew, the word manna literally just means, what is it? I think we call that stew now. We don't really know what's in it. We just know that mom needed to get rid of a whole lot of stuff, and so she chucked it in a pot with some water and some herbs and spices, and then we got stew. It's like manna. What is it? We don't know, but it's going to get you through the day. They were never able to move forward. They wore the same shoes for 40 years. We celebrate the fact the shoes didn't wear out, but that's a long time wearing the same pair of Nikes. They were never able to advance. They were never able to take ground. And suddenly, everything is about to change. In the next season of their life, the floodwaters of the Jordan River are about to supernaturally part as they take steps into it. Every step that they take, God gives it to them and the floodwaters recede. One of the most fortified cities in the old world, Jericho, with walls so thick that they would race chariots around its walls, were about to come down, not after months of starving the people who are on the inside, but because God's people lifted a great shout of praise.
Cities were about to become theirs. Harvests were about to come theirs. Vineyards and orchards and beautiful things were about to become theirs that they had not planted. Everything in their life is about to change. Yet perhaps they were caught in the trap of feeling that though all these things were ahead of them, that they were somehow unable to play their part. One of the greatest lies the devil wants to impart into your mind is the thought that everything that happens in life is going to happen around you, and it's bigger than you, and you therefore are just like a bystander on the side of life watching as everything rolls over you. The devil wants you thinking like Israel thought, that you're weak and impotent, that you can't change history, that the situations are bigger than you, that issues can't be dealt with, and the gangs can't disappear, and the drugs can't be gone, and that the marriages can't be healed, and that the communities can't be restored. But I don't believe in a God who puts you on this planet so that you could watch the world go by. I believe in a God who said, my arm is not too short that it cannot save, that you are the church, you are the light, you're here for a reason, and you can and you will change the world for God. If you believe that's true of you, then give God some praise. How about we take 3 more seconds, it needs a break, and just give God some supernatural praise. Oh, it's true. The devil wants you small. The devil wants you powerless. The devil wants you giving up. The devil wants you thinking you're weak. The devil wants you thinking that you need somebody else. The devil wants you looking at a situation and thinking, I hope Pastor Gus prays over that. The devil wants you thinking, man, we need to do something about this. I hope the government has a solution. And God's saying, no, 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 I'm not sending just one pastor. I'm certainly not sending the government. I'm sending every person in Revelation's church to be the hands and feet of Jesus. And together we're going to change the world. If you believe it, give God some praise. You are the one. You are the one. You are the one. I need to whack 3 people with faith in your eye and tell them, you are the one. You are the one. Come on, take me seriously. Tap 3 people right now. Look at them in the eye and tell them, you are the one. You are the one. You are the one. God can do it. You are the one. You are the one. The truth is, my friends, that God wanted Joshua ready for this moment. He wanted him to realize, you are a slave, Joshua, no more. You are a dependent, no more. I've got miracles for you. I've got blessing for you. I've got favor for you. But if you're going to experience my blessing and my favor, I need you to know that you are the one. And I believe there are hundreds of people in this auditorium tonight, and God is literally saying to you, it's on me to provide the power, but it's on you to be the person that I use. I've got power for you. I've got blessing for you. I've got favor for you. I've got miracles for you. I'm going to bring deliverance through you and healing through you and salvation through you. But I need you to be strong and courageous. That's what God's saying. Because you are the one. You will be the one. You will lead your family. You will impact your city. You will solve this problem. You are the one. You will lead this life group. You will win your school to Jesus. You will bring revival to your university. You will see your family changed. You are the one. God is literally saying, if you see a problem, you can solve it. If you have a dream, you're the one to outwork it. If you receive a promise from God, it's God's will that you would be the one who brings it to pass. Potentially the most important thing that you need to know about you and the world that is around you is that you are the one. It's not the faithless others. It's you. We can easily fall into the trap of waiting for someone else to come, waiting for someone else to help, waiting for somebody else to deliver us, somebody else to come to our aid. And God is saying, no, You are the one. You are the one. We preached about it this morning, but God comes to Abraham and he says, leave your people, leave your father's house and go to the land to which I will show you, and I will make you into a great nation. I've got a nation ahead, Abraham, but you are the one. God comes to Gideon, and the Bible literally says that Gideon in the book of Judges is hiding in a wine press, in a hole in the ground, and he is threshing wheat. The reason why he's doing it is because the Midianites, which is like a powerful army, would come through Israel and they would kill people and they would steal the harvest. At the time when favor was about to be poured out, at a time when Israel was about to move forward, Midian would come down and take everything that was seemingly theirs. They can't seem to get ahead. They can't seem to find peace. And so Gideon is threshing wheat out of fear in a winepress. And God walks up to Gideon and he says, the Lord is with you, mighty man of valor. And you would think that God is somehow being sarcastic. Like, here you are hiding in a hole in the ground. This is the thing you have to get ready for. When God speaks to you, God's never going to speak to fake you. He can't do it. He can't do it. God can't speak to what the devil's trying to make you. That God can't speak to what the demons have lied to you. God can't speak to what your failure made you settle for. When God starts talking to you, the only one he can talk to is the real you. Because he knows you and he loves you and he's got a plan for you. So that's why it feels so weird when God comes to you and he says, you can do all things through Christ who gives you strength. And we're thinking, well, I know, Pastor Gus, that might be true, but not for me. And God's saying, no, because I'm not speaking to the fallen you, the limited you, the failed you, the depressed you. I'm speaking to the real you, the you I made you to be. If you believe that for someone near you, put your hands together and give God some praise. The Lord is with you, mighty man of valor. And then Gideon answers and he says, well, if the Lord is for us, then where are all his wonders? He's saying, if God's with us, then why is everything so bad? And then the Lord replies to Gideon and he says, go in the strength you have and save Israel from the Midianites. You got to get this. You're a mighty man of valor. If God is for us, then why is nothing good happening? Go in the strength you have. Gideon's in a wine press saying, I've been waiting for God. And God's standing on the edge of the wine press saying, buddy, you got it all wrong. I've been waiting for you. I need you to understand, heaven's waiting for you. God is waiting for you. Angels are waiting for you. Favor is waiting for you. Breakthrough is waiting for you. Miracles are waiting for you. If you'll strike the waters, they'll part. If you'll take a step, then the city will. If you'll walk around the city and shout to the Lord, then the walls are going to come crumbling down. It's on you, my friend. God's waiting for you. You are the one. Deborah was a prophetess in the book of Judges, and the Bible says that she comes up to a man by the name of Barak, and she says to Barak, she says, buddy, you are the one. You're to lead Israel. You're to go to battle. You're to vanquish the enemy. You're going to win the battle. This is going to be a new day for the nation. You are the one. And Barak literally says, I won't go and do it. He's told he's the one, and he refuses to take his place. So you can imagine the prophet, she's got a word from God and she's standing there saying, I don't know what to do now. And then she just thinks to herself, well, if Barak won't go, I'm going to go. And even though she wasn't the one, she stepped up and led the nation. And because she was willing to be the one, Israel won victory over their enemies. What are you saying, John? I'm saying it doesn't even matter if you're the right one. It doesn't even matter whether you're the chosen one. It doesn't even matter whether people say you're the one. It doesn't even matter whether God says you're the one. All God's looking for is the willing one. And when you're willing to say, come on, friend, if you believe it, if you're willing to say, I am the one, then God's going to use you for His great glory. And if you believe that, give God some praise in this room right now. You are the one. King Saul, the Bible tells us the first king ever anointed king in Israel was a man by the name of Saul. He was anointed by Samuel. One day, Saul is just going from one place to another. He's tall, he's handsome, he's got big shoulders, he looks the part. And the Bible tells us that Samuel pours anointing oil over his head and literally says to him, you are the one. But the Bible tells us, and we don't know why, how he gave a place for this, how Saul ever ended up in such a situation. But on the day of Saul's coronation, Saul is found hiding among the baggage rather than stepping into what God had for him. Hiding more comfortable amongst the luggage than in the place God had for him. His whole life he was plagued with insecurity, have suffered from bouts of depression, and eventually was stripped of his kingship because he agreed with a lie and refused to believe the truth. Have you ever thought for a moment that some of your low is because you're refusing to believe what is true about you? Ever thought that maybe what is tormenting your mind is a willingness to accept that you're actually a man of God, actually a woman of God, actually ordained of God, full of power from God, that you can and you will change the world? And then the Bible tells us that eventually David comes out. As the band come and join me, that David comes out. He comes out to see the army of Israel. We've got a lot of teenagers in this room tonight. David is about 16 or 17 years old. He literally cannot be 18 years old when this story takes place. He comes out to the battle line, 16 years old, 17 years old. And there is a giant by the name of Goliath who's been taunting the armies of Israel for the last 40 days. He'll come out every morning and he'll come out every evening. Your first thought and your last thought. You want to change your life? Read God's word the moment that you wake and make God's word the last thing you read before you go to sleep. If you give God rather than the devil your first thought, many of us give Facebook our last thought, and Facebook and Instagram our first thought. And then we wonder why we're so filled with fear. David hears the defiance of Goliath. And the Bible tells us that rather than running in fear, he stands tall, he goes to the king, and he says, you should send me to face this giant. I am the one. And Saul looks at David and he says, you're just a boy. This is a giant. You can't take him down. And David says, I've already killed a lion. I've already killed a bear. This giant is going to be next because God's favor is not on Goliath. God's favor is with me. I think I'm preaching to a generation of people here at Revelations who was saying, God is not for the giant. God is not for the devil. God isn't for the dysfunction. God isn't for the brokenness. God isn't for the addiction. God is on my side. Heaven's got my back. The angels of heaven work for me, and I'm gonna vanquish the devil. I am the one. If you believe you're the one, give God some praise in this room right now. I said, give God some praise in this room right now. Like you believe Jericho's walls still come down. Give God some praise in this room right now. Stand to your feet, every single person. Stand to your feet, every single person. Oh, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Tap three people, tell them, I am the one. 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 I mean, there might be another. I know that it's you too. You are the one. Now whack three people and tell them, you are the one. 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 Don't you think for a moment that I'm just hyped up here trying to get you excited? No. I was sent here by God to preach this message tonight because God's raising up a generation of people here at Revelations Church. And I'm telling you, this might be your next building, but it's not your last building. It's gonna feel small soon too because God's got bigger for you and greater for you. A generation to be won, addictions to be broken, a church to be established, an army to be risen up. We're going to change our schools and change our unis, change our communities, change our workplaces. God is working wonders on our behalf. If you believe it, give heaven a shout. Yeah! The atmosphere is changing. The atmosphere is changing. The atmosphere is changing. Not because of me, but because of you. If you believe it, shout, I am the one. 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 Give your God a shout of praise in this room right now. Give your God a shout of praise.
Atmosphere said, atmosphere.
God, I speak to the identity confusion, to the lies that the devil's been trying to put in the minds of so many fine people in this room this evening. I speak to that false narrative that you're just a small player in a very big world. I speak to that lie that you can't do it because of what happened yesterday. I speak right now to that shame, to that self-deprivation. I speak to everything that's trying to pull you down. And in the name of Jesus, I say, be still, be gone. We break your hold. I declare over every person in this room tonight, come Holy Spirit. The power of God is just beginning to fall in this room tonight. If you're hungry for God, open your heart. Open your heart. Lift your hands. Oh, oh. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. Man, some people are sensing the power of God literally touching you right where you are in this room. You are the one. 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 That's God. That's God. You are the one. He's filling you. You are the one. You are the one. I'm telling you, courage is filling this room right now. Boldness is filling this room right now. Resolve. There are men. There are men deciding, I'm the next Dane Coles for my community, for my family. There's an hour. I'm shaking off my cloak. I'm never going back. I'm driving home for the service, but I'm never going back. I'm going to be different from tonight onwards because I am the one. I am the one. If you believe it, shout it out tonight. Shout, I am the one. I am the one. I am the one. Three more times. I am the one. I am the one. I am the one. Now give him a shout of praise one more time in this room tonight. It's like the precursor to a dream. It's just the knowledge that the hand of God is on your life. This is happening for many people. I'm called of God. That's what you're beginning to think right now. That's a good thought. I'm special. Yes, you are. I can do something great for God. Yes, you can. God's never going to belittle you. Other people will, but He won't. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your touch. Thank you for your touch. Thank you for your touch. If something's coming alive in you tonight, letting you know that the hand of God is on your life, that you are the one, if you know destiny is on you, and I want you to take both hands, lift them high in the air tonight. Come on, do it nice and high. I want people around. They've got their eyes closed, but if their eyes were open, I want them to know that you're not going to cower in the shadows anymore. We need an army. We need an army, Lord. We got a world full of problems, but God, we got a room full of solutions. We got a world full of problems, but tonight we got a room full of solutions. Father, in the name of Jesus, I declare a new anointing over your people. Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give to you. I will give you every place where you set your foot. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. So be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. For you are. You are. You are the one. I declare this tonight. I declare this tonight. In Jesus' mighty name. Keep your eyes closed, but put your hands down, please. Just keep your eyes closed all over this room. There are many people that have come to the service tonight, and right now you're not connected to Jesus. You've come to Revelations this evening, but you don't have your own relationship with God. So many in this room, and you're in this auditorium tonight, but you know that you're not a Christian. It's not good enough just to be a religious person. Going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than going to McDonald's makes you a hamburger. It's got to be personal. It's got to be real. It's got to be in your heart. Maybe you're here tonight and you've been a church person, but you know that Jesus is not at the center of your life. Or perhaps you've got no idea whether you're a Christian or not. If that's you, my friend, I need you to know Jesus loves you. God has a plan for you. He's proud of you. He accepts you. He's got a destiny for you. You're in this room because a loving God wanted you to be here. And all it takes for you to have your own relationship with the God who created you and the God who loves you is for you to open up your heart to Him and open up your mouth to Him. Open up your heart to His truth and open up your mouth and pray to Him. I'm going to lead us all in a prayer all across this auditorium. Everybody's going to pray the prayer. But many people are in this room saying, John, I need to pray this prayer because I'm not right with Jesus. I'm not connected to God. I'm not a Christian. I promise you, if you'll pray this prayer with me, tonight could be the night where you discover what it is to know Jesus personally. What I want you to do so that I know who I'm praying this prayer with. If you're in this room tonight and you need Jesus, I'm going to ask you in just one moment to take one hand and lift it high in the air. If you're here and you're saying, I'm not connected to God, I want you to lift your hand. John, I'm not a Christian. I want you to lift your hand. If you've been a church person, but Jesus is not at the center of your life, I want you to lift your hand. If you've got no idea whether you're a Christian or not, I want you to lift your hand. People are going to lift their hands all over the room, and then we're going to pray this prayer together. But all over this auditorium, right now, many people are saying, John, you're talking to me. I need Jesus. If that's you, friend, wherever you are, take one hand and lift it high in the air right now. Lift it all the way up. Lift it all the way up. Thank you. 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 Keep lifting them. Keep lifting them. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Keep lifting them. Keep lifting them. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So many hands. So many hands. Everybody in the room, say this prayer out loud with me. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you. I need you in my life. I'm lost without you. I ask you, Jesus, come into my life. Be my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sin. I thank you, Jesus. You accept me. You love me. You forgive me. I thank you. Amen. Can we have the biggest clap of the night? Come on, the biggest clap of the night for every person saying yes to Jesus. We love you, we love you, we love you, we love you, we love you. Thank you, church. Great honor. Can we welcome Pastor Gus, the great man of God?
Can I get the executive team, pastors, and also the comms team, your husbands, if you can please come out and stand with us. Woo! Who enjoyed that? Listen to me very carefully. That word that was preached tonight was absolutely prophetic. Let me tell you why. The greatest enemy in our city, Blacktown, especially in the areas of Blacktown, is this thing called the inferior complex. The world has beaten us down to believe that God can bless them. God can bless him. God is using them, but God can never use me. And that word came in like a double-edged sword, and God is pleading with you to say, listen, if you can believe that God can use you, then God can do it. This isn't about just having nice little church services. It's not just about getting together. It's about changing a generation. And it's going to take an army. It's going to take you. Come on, just one more time. Look at the person next to you and say, I think you're the one. We're going to praise party. Listen, we're going to seal it. But I'm going to ask John to come up, John. Come on, Apostle John. Man. We love you. Thank you so much for just your humility, your excellence, your strength, your foresight. Thank you for pouring and giving it all you've got. We're going to take everything. Amen, church. And we're going to outwork it. We're going to put our hands to the plow. And while we're at it, we're going to put our back into it. And we're going to drive until the kingdom of God becomes a reality. But we're forever grateful. We've always been a house of honor. Honor releases the gift. Jesus said, if you honor a prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. And as we honor the man of God, whatever was on his life will be downloaded into our midst, that we would continue to build the glorious kingdom of Jesus. And we just want to pray for you and honor you. We've got a little gift for you, Michelini. Just an honorarium for the church to thank you so much for all your amazing work. And just, we're going to sing Kuwe. If everyone can just stretch out your hands right now as we just honor the Apostle John and Gillian Cameron and his family. Kuwe, Baba, kipe kite, Kuwe. Father, we thank you for bringing your servant here, a general in the faith, an apostle in your kingdom. Father, we lift up John and Jillian. We thank you for the gift that is on the inside of them. We receive everything that has been poured out to us. Give us the grace to outwork and produce its fruit. And Father, we begin to prophesy over what you've got on this man's life, what you will use him to do, to bring revival to cities and nations, to raise up a generation, oh God. Oh, Father, greater works. The word greater works is coming. Eye has not seen, ear has not even heard what God has on the other side. What the enemy meant for evil, God is going to expend 10 times. Father, I thank you, Lord God. Just that resurrection power coming through you, raising a generation of people, deploying them across the land. Oh, Father, we thank you for the voice, Lord God, that is upon this man. Father, we give you all the glory as we release it to you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said, amen. We love you, John. Okay. We're going to close it off, Pastor. Take us in a praise party. But if they're going to praise, you better praise. Pray safely. God bless you.
The night, one day to little heart, his weary soul. It's like a bow. I traveled all my mind. I just came when the fire was only dimming. And then, you know, sing. And just when I say, just when I
lost another one.
I am free.
Hey!
I am free. I am free.
Sing!
I lost another one.
I am free. That's it.
I am free. I am free.
Say!
I lost another one. I am free.
Sing!
I am free.
Yeah.
I am free. I lost another one. I am free. I am free.
I lost that one, say!
Yeah, lost that one, I am free.
Hey,
I am free. I am free.
Hello!
Yeah, lost that one,
I am free. I am free.
I am free.
Yeah,
lost that one,
I am free.
I am free. I
lost that one.
Yeah, lost that one,
I am free. I am free. Pick me up, sing!
Pick me up.
Hey!
Solid ground,
nothing that's if sealed in my heart. Sing my name, forever free. I'm not the same. I'm dead to mass. Come on, let's go. Pick me up, sing.
Pick me up, turn me around. Place my feet on solid ground. I've been master, I've been saved.
Because of you,
heal my heart. Change my name.
won't you scream as loud Jesus' name? 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Love you, family. God bless you all. Please, family, can you join me and honor the man of God, Pastor John Cameron? Love you all. God bless you all. We'll see you next Sunday. Have a good night. God bless, family.
Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How could you see your life was the only gift I left for me to be free? It's amazing with you. I win even if I lose. Everything's working for my good for always.
Come on.
He said
hallelujah.